So far, we have been looking at the sun as the main source of energy, either directly using photovoltaics or indirectly by wind and biomass. But we have a source of energy that is right below us, planet Earth. A very long time ago, planet Earth was nothing but a hot globe of molten rock. Luckily for us, the Earth has cooled down to a point where we won't burn our feet when we stand outside. However, the Earth's crust as we know it is still only a very thin layer of cold rock, basically floating on a sea of lava. If we go down a few kilometers, we can already start using the heat. The general principle of geothermal energy is relatively simple. Hot water is pumped up from an underground reservoir. The heat in the groundwater is extracted with a heat exchanger and used above ground. Finally, the cooled water is re-injected at a different location under the ground to permeate through the rock where it is warmed up again. The depth of the reservoirs can vary between several hundred meters to 5 kilometers. The underground area from which the water is extracted should be large enough. To even out the extraction of water and to avoid mixing the injected cold water with hot water from the extraction, often multiple extraction holes are drilled with a large distance between them. The streams are in close circle to avoid pollution of the groundwater. Let's take a look at one of the largest geothermal power stations in the world. The Hellisheiði power station in Iceland has an installed electrical capacity of 303 megawatts, as well as 133 megawatts of thermal capacity. We will focus on the electricity generation to keep it comparable with the other technologies we have discussed so far. The general principle of this power station is using hot water from the earth to power steam turbines. This process converts heat energy into mechanical energy, which in turn is converted into electricity with an electric generator. This principle is also used in coal, biomass, and concentrated solar plants. Geothermal energy is not intermittent and can therefore be used as a base load for electricity grids. A capacity factor of a geothermal plant with a size like this will be estimated at 0.8, so around 80%. The capacity factor is not one due to the downtime because of maintenance and considering some time that the installation will not produce at maximum power capacity. Now we can roughly calculate the total electricity energy yield of this power station by multiplying 303 megawatts by 8,760 hours in a year and a capacity factor of 0.8, which equals roughly 2.12 terawatt hours or 5.8 megawatt hours per day. Considering that Iceland has a very small population of roughly 300,000 people, this means this plant generates about 18 kilowatt hours per person per day or 6.2 human energy units. However, a significant amount of this energy is used for aluminium melting. Let's do another back of the envelope calculation to estimate the potential of geothermal energy. The average heat flux in the Earth's crust is about 50 milliwatts per square meter. Combined with an overall efficiency of 10%, which takes into account the efficiency of the rock as a heat exchanger, the thermal efficiency and the electrical efficiency and the other system losses, we get that we can only use 5 milliwatts per square meters of heat. This leads to an achievable energy density of 0.04 kilowatt hours per square meters. However, this potential can only be achieved at places where the permeability of the rock is sufficient. In addition, to make it economically feasible, it is important that heat can be collected at a reachable depth. Iceland is on a fault line. Here, the Earth crust is warm, even relatively close to the surface. This explains all the geysers and the massive use of geothermal energy in Iceland. So, a geothermal plant can act as a base load for the electricity grid to eliminate the use of gas and coal plants. Not all locations are suitable for geothermal energy, and drilling to find the right rock type can be very expensive. However, the average lifetime of a geothermal plant is at least 30 years. After that, the heat reservoir needs time to recover again or will produce a lot of less power. Another benefit is that because the actual heat collection will take place underground, the ground above it can be used for other purposes. As a result, the land use is very small of a geothermal plant. Geothermal energy is one of the smallest contributors in sustainable energy, with an installed capacity of 12.8 gigawatt in 2015. However, its potential is huge. Some estimations are in the order of 1500 gigawatt if enough capital is available. Nowadays, the global production of geothermal energy is 89.6 terawatt hours of electricity. This comes down to a little less than 0.5% of the global electricity production and about 1.5% of all renewable electricity. If we divide it by the global population of 7.4 billion people and days in a year, we will get 0.03 kilowatt hours per person per day, which is 1% of our own daily energy need. Geothermal energy is another piece of the puzzle to move towards a more sustainable future. The installation sizes vary from hundreds of megawatts to single house systems for private use, which are becoming more common these days. On this scale, water is stored in the ground under or close to a building. This water is used in the winter to heat up a house. In the summer, the water can be used to cool a building down. In the following exercises, we will make a rough estimate on the energy potential of such systems. And see you back in the next video blog.